For 10 years, I've been practicing and thinking about the relationship of human beings to the land, and there's a lot of different philosophies that kind of come in and are pieces of the puzzle.
I really think there's a really bigger and broader perspective about the purpose of the landscape, and I think that that's really kind of left out of the conversation about people's yards or even industrial land. And most people just plant things because it's going to be low maintenance and it's going to look pleasant. And that's really where the conversation stops.
I think something that's happening more and more is people are putting right plant in the right place and thinking about serving more than just the human aesthetic and providing for butterflies and birds and bees. This project is really unique based on that collaborative process of the landscape contractor, the landscape architect, an architect, a client, and the general contractor all being at the table from the very beginning.
And coming into that process when the house is still being designed, I think makes a better end product.
Yeah.
And it also saves time and money for everybody, and I think the client gets more of what they want.
Because it's a passive house and because we're dealing with solar gain and, you know, the orientation to the sun is very important, the house has a lot of windows on the south face, which is very purposeful. We don't want to put evergreen trees up close to the house that are going to limit that solar gain in the winter. In the summer, we want to have trees there that are deciduous, that provide shade, so that we're actually minimizing the amount of sun that's coming in when it's really hot. And then when it's cold, we want the most sun to be in the house. This project is really a wonderful example of how to use zones in a landscape design. And so close to the house is her agriculture, her high yield crops that she needs to pay attention to, things that she might need to get involved with every day. And then as you step away, there's another ring with more kind of fruit trees and fruiting shrubs where they need attention, but they don't need as much attention day to day. And then we're stepping out to basically a native landscape where we're trying to restore with native trees and shrubs. I think that idea of kind of leaving a piece of your landscape for kind of the wild zone is something that people, I think, are acknowledging. You know, let the birds kind of have their berries, kind of, you know.
Catch water and move it down into the berm, along the berm.
Now on full plane, we're on a slope that's about a 16% slope, and this slope is a small piece of a large slope. So we're a small little subdivision of land in a much larger hill. And there's water coming from the top of that hill and going to the bottom. And so what we tried to do on this project is hold as much of the water on site as we could. And so what we did is try to create swales and rain gardens to catch the water.
If the water's running down the hillside, rather than just continuing to go down the hill, it's going to just stop and it's going to soak in here a little bit. So I kind of built it so there's a little overflow. If you get too much water, then it'll go down to the next berm. But basically the purpose of this is that we're slowing water down as it moves along the landscape. And what that does is gets the water to infiltrate into the ground.
And we're putting plants that can handle the water kind of sitting on their roots for a while and let it infiltrate in those spots. And the goal has been to use the water where it lands and not let as much run off into the neighbor's yard and then, you know, collectively into the watershed. I do love plants, yes. It makes the energy of the project come down to earth when the plants arrive. It's really wonderful.
You know, it's important to remember that there is a whole series of other businesses and suppliers and groups of people that do their business, do their part really well in order to help us do this. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, appreciate it.
And so I think most people don't think about all the skill and expertise that goes into growing plants and growing things in a way that you can transport it and then put it on the ground and have it live, be successful. So I think that's something that we really appreciate and value, is having good suppliers to help us do our job. Basically reforesting the whole bottom part of this property. We're planting a lot of trees.
And we're seeding the entire property with a meadow mix, which will help to hold the ground and get some roots in there and be the transition till the plants really fill in.
So this is one of the first landscapes where I feel like I'm actually planning for 50 or 100 year scale. We're planting a lot of trees that are pretty densely planted together, and over time it's going to turn back into a forest, which is pretty exciting to have that opportunity to do that. No one ever thinks about scale of time. People think about, oh, I want a pretty yard, I want to enjoy it, I want to entertain, I want it to be a nice space, but people aren't really thinking about, if I'm going to put something in, like how is it going to really go beyond my lifetime, and what can I leave for people in their lifetime and then their kids' lifetime, you know? That's really one thing I wish people thought a lot more about.
That's beautiful.
So basically today what we're doing is just coming back and putting in a little top dressing of compost, just because of the rain the last couple of months. It's washed a little bit away. Hopefully that doesn't happen again. The area where the planters are, the soil settled quite a bit, so we need to put another foot of compost in that. For most people, you know, you're creating a cool and beautiful space, but I really think there's like a really bigger and broader perspective about the purpose of dealing with a landscape. And that can be as small as a tiny little backyard, or that can be as big as like acres and acres of land in a rural area. And really what I think it comes down to is like understanding resources and managing resources in a way that's smart.
As a designer and thinking about how human beings relate to the land, which is a lot of what I spend my time thinking about, I would say that permaculture does a really great job of describing a way to think about the land in a holistic sense, and to think about systems, and to think about how we stack functions and how we are efficient with the land and respond to the natural environment using natural systems as inspiration. And I think that's all really powerful and important. And one thing is the aesthetic aspect, that when you're working with a home that's so well designed and so there's so much attention to detail.
Yes, exactly there.
The landscape has to respond to that level of kind of high design. And so to how to figure out how to incorporate this level of design that we're talking about and natural systems and honoring them and how to make that all work together is kind of, that's where I get really excited.
You really think about like everything that we use to live comes from plants and rocks. I think really understanding that and using that philosophy when you're managing land, whether it's small or large, really can redefine how we interact with each other in a community sense or how we live individually. It affects quality of life.
Something else grew with the plants.
Well, it seems like a good thing. Well, I also
6 months later.
Go visit some stuff in Japan, so.
I have been doing this for
12 years and I still show up and am blown away that it all works. Every time I come, I'm like, it's all working and all the plants are growing and everything's happy, and it just really blows my mind every time.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, I think it's been an amazing experience to talk about something for a really long time and put a lot of thought into it and execute it.
And this is the satisfaction piece, is walking to the landscape in the spring after it's planted and seeing that things are surviving.
It likes water, so that's why it did
really... Oh, right
really
there.
So, just wondering about if you're really feeling the effects of us planning for your zones.
Yes.
So that you have, you know, the things that you need to pay the most attention to closest to your house. So
right. Yeah, because all the, you know, the herbs, which obviously you're going to use, you know, pretty much daily, are at the top box. And then we've got things that are, they're not quite yet ready to harvest, but everything is right accessible off the porch.
Yeah.
Look at this.
This is exciting.
Plum.
This is the plum.
And then eventually plum. Once all the fruit trees come, which we'll be, you know, gathering, you know, 5 apples a day.
Yeah.
Right here at the top of the yard. And yeah, and just in here, it's just something we get to just enjoy, you know, just looking at things from here. We don't have to really pick or cut or do anything down here. It's just more for really looking when you're walking down.
Yeah. And there's a lot of things down here too that are gonna bury that you could eat, but if you choose not to, then the birds will eat.
Right. So
that's the other piece that I think
the beneficial.
Yeah. Birds and insects as well.
So. Yeah.
Lisa has a hive, and so she wanted to provide plants with nectar and pollen for her bees. This is called sea holly. It's Oryngium, and it is a great bee plant. Bees love it. Bees love this blue color, and there's pollen that they collect off of this plant. And another great thing about this plant is it is really drought tolerant. And lastly, they're just amazing looking, and they really go well with the palette out here that we chose. So I just think they're a fantastic addition to a garden. Our job is to put in a good foundation, meaning good soil, proper grading, proper drainage, right plant in the right place, and it all gets installed well and everything happens, and then we have to leave and hope that the client pays attention and is thoughtful and careful about how they care for it.
It takes 5 to 7 years to kind of see what actually works. The thing is, it's a whole season, so it's 12 months from where things are dormant, things pop out, they grow, they do something, then you have that observation.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you don't really understand something for 2 or 3 years, which is kind of fun and exciting, and it's always a never-ending story with how things are doing.
Yeah.
But it also takes that much time before you start to even understand what's going on. And
gardens tend to sleep, creep, and then leap. And basically the first year you put plants in, they're kind of getting used to their new home and they're not as vigorous as they will be, but they're just kind of feeling out their new territory. And the second year they'll slowly start to emerge, so that's the creep. And then the leap is that third year where every plant, if it's treated well and cared for, seems to just pop. So sleep, creep, and leap. So by year three, it doesn't mean that year four is going to be a downhill turn. It just means from there it will be a lush garden. But those first 2 years, you kind of have to be patient with your plants and know that they're just kind of getting their roots in to live a good, long, healthy, happy life. Lisa emailed me to say that she's very excited about her yard and it makes her happy every day, and she's out here all the time, which is just the point of all of this, connecting people to their little piece of earth that they get to kind of play with.
There's something really miraculous about the fact that you can put seeds in the ground and they grow.
Yeah.
And I feel like for modern people, especially if you don't have that connection with growing plants, it seems like it's this big complex process, and it totally is, but you're not involved in that. You're just sticking a seed into the ground and it's coming back up, and I think that's so important to realize that things will grow and that nature still works and that not all hope is lost. And I think that's a really powerful and amazing thing to experience.
What I think is amazing in terms of trying to do the landscape in this way, and this is what I think Aaron is so good at, is if you look at this section drawing, the really big conifers are at the far south, but you can't see it. Whereas, as an architect and with the building, once it's done, you know, it looks kind of like the drawings did. Whereas this isn't going to look like the drawing did until
a long time.
20,
yeah,
till she's our age, right?
Till she, yeah.